roster, weren't we updated? Should be updated online. We just put their eligibility years. We'll figure out everything else once the NCAA gives us some direction. So the only year listed is eligibility right now on the website. All right, with that, Tom, why don't you start us with an opening statement, and then we'll go to John Blau for the first question.
All right, appreciate everybody being with us this afternoon. Excited to be back, ready for spring football tomorrow. Really looking forward to that. I've had a great six-week period with our guys in the weight room. Coach Wellman and his staff done a tremendous job with that group and on a consistent basis. And so looking forward to just get back on the field with our guys. A lot of guys back from the 2020 season, as you know. And so anxious to see these guys run around a little bit. And we'll be in helmets only the first couple of days, but also a lot of excitement building up for that. Three goals for spring football. Number one, really want to do a great job of improving our fundamentals and technique with an emphasis on just relentless toughness in everything that we do. Number two, for me, it's about developing our depth in all three phases, offense, defense, special teams, and then also scheme adjustments that you always do in the springtime. Looking forward to those opportunities for us to grow our team and continue to improve and get better. As far as some new things to add, Brandon Shelby is going to be our assistant head coach. Moved him into that role. Excited for his growth and development there. Also, Casey Teagarden is going to be have the responsibilities of both the Bull and the Husky, which is we're labeling that as an outside linebackers coach in addition to doing special teams, which he worked with those guys last fall. But being able to name that a little differently, just our edge guys. And then also a couple of roster adjustments. Caleb Murphy has moved. We moved to tight end last fall, which gave us some depth there. We're moving back to the defensive line. Gavin McCabe also moving back to the defensive line as well, and where he started off. And so we really feel good about the depth they can give us there and competing to play. We got an open competition there at that three technique spot with our two upperclassmen moving on to the NFL. And so excited to see how that plays itself out. And then as far as the bowl position, DK Bonham and Lance Bryant and Mike Ziemba, those three guys are listing those guys as bowls, which is our weak side hybrid outside linebacker type person. So that's all I have right now as far as the updates. Just really, really looking forward to getting back on the football field tomorrow and getting rolling. Questions?
All right, John, and then Zach.
Obviously, there's another piece of news today with you getting a contract kind of rework. Obviously, the money's one thing, but in terms of just them, the administration showing how much they value you, I mean, what does it mean to you to kind of have that contract, and how much does it say in terms of your intent to be here for a long time, being that you're going to be compensated at that level?
Well, you know, just so appreciative and very, very thankful for Scott Dolson. Just appreciate his commitment to our football program. President Robbie has been huge in all of this, and board of directors, board of trustees, excuse me. So just really appreciate all of them, the leadership of Indiana. I've said all along, you know, it's about wanting to be at a place that values our football program, that's going to invest in our football program and allow us to be able to have the infrastructure and the support to do great things here. And that's what I want us to be able to do. And I appreciate their support in that area and all that they've chosen to invest in football at Indiana University. So special time for us, and we're just very, very blessed and very appreciative of it.
All right, Zach, then Matt Weaver.
Yes, Tom, I know it's not as simplistic as putting a piece of paper, you know, down in front of a potential assistant or a potential recruit or whatever, but between this and you know, some of the assistant contracts you've been able to offer in the last couple of years, I mean, at the risk of oversimplifying it, do you feel like people look at IU football differently, react to IU football differently, maybe not just because of the results, but also because when you talk about, you know, administrative commitment or whatever it may be, there's maybe something there that speaks for itself?
There is. And, you know, and we talk to this with recruits, and, you know, we always have the conversations about facilities and why they're important. And when I talk to recruits and their families about why facilities are important, it's because it shows commitment. It shows investment. It shows the priority for football at IU. And so, and this is an extension of that, you know. And you think about this too, when you talk to recruits and their families, and, you know, they want to know, are you going to be coaching my son, you know, when he's a sophomore and junior and senior, and because that's a big deal. And so things like this send a strong message that direction, the commitment of the university and the commitment of myself and our family to being here. And so that means a lot to me. And it obviously puts a lot of, a lot of power behind your words, that it's not just something that I'm saying. This is the action of the people here that, are in charge of these areas of responsibility in Indiana and the decisions that they chose to make for this. And it's a tribute to our coaching staff, all the players that have come here and believed and bought in and have just created an unbelievable environment. So it's just so many layers. You're right. It's not a simple answer. There's not a simple, piece to this. But, boy, just speaks so strongly to that the culture we've created here, and I say we very strongly. Man, it's taken so many people. It's taken several years. It just didn't happen overnight. So much relationship building, and that's going to continue. And to me, that's the whole point, is that I want to continue to build off the foundation that we've laid here at Indiana, and want to allow this to be able to, to be what I envisioned it to be, when I first got here, and to be able to compete at the highest level in this conference and across this country. And so to be able to have that, this is kind of a next step for us, as a program, and as we move forward, and as this our university has chosen to invest in our coaching staff and everybody that's a part of this program. So very, very big step for us for sure, and excited about what the future holds.
Matt and Kevin.
Hey, Coach, congrats on your new deal.
Thank you. I appreciate that.
Obviously, you had some staff changes as far as your, on the field or, full-time staff, but you also lost, a GA on each side of the ball and a recruiting guy. Any anywhere on replacements for those two guys on the offensive GA, defensive GA, and then, Coach Dwight Wilson's spot at recruiting?
Yes, we're moving forward with those. The exciting thing for all those opportunities you had, Danny had a chance to go get a full-time job, and obviously, just with Dwight going down there with Kane, have a chance to get on the field, and I know that was a huge goal for him and his future, and then Seth being able to go and be with Kane and move forward and be able to have a position to coach on the field and have his own room was a big deal for him. And so three guys that I really appreciate all their hard work here. And in the process of getting those positions filled, and there's a sequence you have to go through with the GA ships, and for them to be able to come here and get in classes and be able to get accepted into those graduate programs, and doesn't just happen quickly sometimes. And so we're just kind of working through all that right now. Same with the recruiting position, and as is always the case here, it's always about getting the right fits for us. Guys that understand who we are, understand our culture, want to be here. But yeah, it's you see it in all these areas, just the heightened interest of guys wanting to be a part of this culture, of this environment we've created, and be able to help us continue to build it and take the next step as a program. So those are positions that we're in the process of getting filled.
Kevin, then Rick Bozich.
Hey, Coach, I have kind of like two quick questions for me, but the first one might be quick. The status of Jalen Williams going into spring football, where is he as far as his taking part in it?
Yeah, so at this point, just still going through the process of figuring out all the details of every component to that. And so at this point, he'll still be with us and doing things with the team. That's not changed. And so, but still don't have a final verdict on all the things that the court system brings back to us. But, we're just working through that together with him.
And secondly, you're coming up on the 1-year anniversary of when sports shut down for COVID. I remember you saying that you were kind of in Florida on spring break at the time, but what do you think you've learned in this past year in the COVID environment, and how are you maybe even going to have to continue to be careful even though, numbers are improving?
Well, first of all, we're still on this, with similar protocols. We're still testing our guys multiple times a week currently, and that will continue throughout spring football. We're wearing masks in the buildings. Won't be wearing them on the practice field or during outdoor workouts as far as the players don't. Coaches will still be doing that during practice. So some of those things have not changed. You think about it, when this happened, like I said, a year ago, you know, and we had our first four practices in, and then we left for spring break, and then everything changed. And so, yeah, we have learned an awful lot, you know, and I think that right now we're trying to figure out what, you know, what's the rest of spring going to look like, what's recruiting going to look like, what's camps going to look like, the summertime. Don't have a lot of answers for that right now, but, you know, I think just the ability to be able to be flexible and adapt to things, you know, and the utilization of technology in recruiting has continued. You know, the Zoom calls have become a huge part of the whole process, and virtual tours and virtual everything has not changed. So that's really, we're in the same boat, you know, more so. At this time last year, we didn't even know about any of that stuff yet. And so, but at the same time, you have to be able to make pretty quick adjustments. You know, a lot of preliminary plans for May and June and July without a lot of answers yet. So that kind of has taught us that you still got to have great planning. You just don't know what those ultimate, you know, calendars are going to look like. You know, so we have to have a lot of things that are in place, ready to go when we get the green light for that to be the case. So a lot of unanswered questions still for what lies ahead, but we're going to be very, very cautious in regards to this virus and how we have to deal with it. And moving forward, we're taking nothing for granted. Yeah, the numbers are definitely improving, you know, in this area for sure, and across the country, but we're not going to let up. We just want to make sure we're doing everything we can to protect our players and our staff.
All right, Rick, and then Rabbi.
Yeah, Tom, we had Michael on a Zoom call a couple of weeks ago. What are your expectations or hopes that he can achieve, I guess, during the spring? And I'm sure he's not going to, you know, participate in the scrimmages or anything like that, but is your expectation that he will be able to play in August when camp arrives?
Yeah, he's done a tremendous job following everything we've asked him to do from a medical perspective. Been, you know, meeting with him, meeting with his staff, you know, with him, and just different things to get him mentally growing and developing as a leader, growing, developing in his understanding of you know, defenses and all the different things he has to do, you know, to run the offense, and so just keep building and progressing. So he's just extremely diligent in those areas, and just want to see him just keep growing, you know, like all of our guys. You know, I just want him to take another step in his growth and the holistic part of how he has to approach the game and be able to get where he needs to be. And so, yeah, we expect him to be ready to play to start the season. It's obviously got a progression there. Won't see much here this spring with him. You know, he's just going to follow those protocols. He will definitely not be taking any reps with anybody around him. You know, still definitely going to be able to throw some footballs around, do things like that. But pretty limited in that regard. But at the same time, feel really good about the future and the way he's been able to progress so far and the prognosis we've been given from the doctors. And so very optimistic about his, you know, availability and not just, you know, from that perspective. I would say we're expecting him to be full bore when the season starts.
All right, Rabbi, and then Dylan Wallace.
Yeah, hey, Coach. As you get ready for spring ball, what position group do you feel is clearly the strongest? What position group do you look at and say, we probably got the most work to do in that area?
Well, let me kind of break it down. Each side of the ball is kind of hard. We've got so many guys back on this team, and some of these guys have played so much football. You know, I would say that, you know, we do have some questions at receiver, just because we've got so many different guys that are kind of in that middle group that have played some and got some new faces, also got some real strong veterans coming back. But I just think there's a lot of question marks there as far as some of these younger guys, how much of a step are they going to be able to take to be able to really give us true depth at that position. I think our offensive line has a chance to be one of our strengths on offense. I think that a number of guys that have played on that side of the football, you know, basically got the entire unit back except for Harry Kreider. And so just really excited about their development in the weight room these past several weeks and their future development. And we're going to still lift 3 days a week during spring football, which is huge because we are still have a huge priority in that weight room and being able to get our guys where they need to be by September. And so I think that's the areas I would kind of address on the offensive side of football. Defensively, you know, I would say, you know, probably the strength of our secondary, or strength of our defense is probably in our secondary. When you bring back Marcelino Ball and a guy like Raheem Lane, who neither one of them played last year, And so basically, Jamar Johnson is really the only guy that you lost back there. So a strong group that we expect, as well as the linebacker core. You know, they're all back. But I think defensive line, just as an area, we lost some guys there. The guys need to step up, some younger guys. I've already mentioned the three technique position is going to be an intense competition. And we got to develop depth. As I said, it's one of our goals for spring. And I think the defensive line, to me, is an area I really want to focus on and see us continue to grow and develop. Yeah, we led the Big Ten in sacks as a team last year. But those all weren't from the guys up front. They came from the secondary, came from the linebacker position as well. So just want to continue to develop our guys in both stopping the run up front defensively and then putting pressure on the quarterback. So those would be the areas I would address those for.
All right, Tom Brew for Dylan and then Paul Gable.
Hey, Tom, with your new restructuring there and your deal, was there a bump in the pool for assistance as well with that this time around?
Yes, and so that was a big part. As a matter of fact, when this whole thing started, that was my very first response was, I want to take care of our guys first, you know. And so I've been able to do some of those types of things, even though we're, you know, in dealing with challenges across the board for everybody. And so, but to me, that's definitely a huge part of this. And we were able to do that a year ago as well, and just continuing to build on the infrastructure that we have and our staff members and being able to support those guys and reward those guys for their hard work and their areas of performance within their groups. And so those are things that, yes, we're able to address and continue to invest in.
And can you just say something real quick on the move with Brandon and what you see in Brandon that will help you with that role? I know how important that role is to you.
It is, and that's something that I have really taken very seriously here. You know, sometimes certain staffs, you know, those roles can be just titles that they give to people just for, you know, pay purposes or different things. But I really choose to do it in a way that's very purposeful, that helps, you know, helps our staff get better, you know. And I know he's a guy that he and I, as we've talked, and his, you know, you talk about what, you know, we did with Mike Hart and his desire to want to be a head coach one day. And same with Dylan McCullough and as associate head coach and with Brandon Shelby, his same desire to want to be a head coach one day and grow in his area. I feel like he has a really strong personality to be able to address our players and has a good connection with our players and understands them well. And that assistant head coach role to me. So we had a meeting together with myself and Dylan and Brandon and Mike and Mike Doig. And so we all four of us sat together and just kind of mapped out their areas of responsibilities and where I really need them to help us. And so it's very specific things that we go through. And so we really need his help and support to, you know, keep a pulse of our team and being able to be a great voice to our players and understanding situations off the field, even on the field, you know, even things in the facility wise, just giving me a great temperature and pulse of our team with him. And because he's been here for so long, knows our guys, both sides of the football. And then just the practical things of being able to learn how the different roles that you have as a coach that most people never see. And so those are things that we've decided to go about and really address with those two guys and help me become a better head coach, because it's like everything else that we do here, we're all in this together, and we don't care gets credit because it's not about me, and those guys have that same mindset. And that's why you try to be able to put those guys in more leadership positions to where they can, you know, learn the role of a head coach and also help support myself and the entire staff to make us stronger.
Paul and then Dustin.
Hey, Coach, how excited are you to get back out there with new pieces in terms of your early enrollees, new pieces in the coaching staff, and also your expectations for Jack Tuttle this spring? And then how is Thomas doing with his rehab?
Yeah, you know, I'm very excited. You know, that's what I love about spring. You know, you have, you know, new guys that come in mid-year. We had several of those, anxious to see what they are able to do on the football field. You've seen them in the weight room workouts and the running and the indoor on those different things. But with the ball out there and playing football, you know, seeing where they're at and whether it's the three, you know, transfers that came to us collegially or the high school guys that came to us right from high school. So looking forward to that. And then, as you mentioned, we got two new coaches as well. Be able to see them out there with their guys. And you know, I've coached with Dylan McCullough before, but never coached with Charlton. And to see him lead our defense, that excites me. You know, I'm really looking forward to seeing him. You know, we've been in some heavy meetings for ever since he got here. Actually, before he got here, we started on Zoom. And then when he got here physically, it's been in person. So just love his leadership style, love his organization. Attention to detail is very, very high level and very meticulous, which is what I love. And so anxious to see him out there, you know, holding the guys accountable, see his energy at practice. I know he's going to have that. And just the attention to detail as he coaches, you know, and as we hold our guys to high standards of how we practice. And that's the thing to me. I love spring ball because you don't have, you know, when you get into the season, it's always a, you know, you always get ready for a game. And so you have that deadline. It kind of drives things and makes you have to go through things at a certain tempo. Whereas here you got a lot of time to teach, a lot of time to go through very, very thoroughly of your fundamentals and your technique, the things that we believe separate us and allow us to have an edge about ourselves here and how we play the game, and be able to really spend time, you know, reinforcing those things. And it's the culture you want to build, you know, with how your team's known when you take the field and how you play this game on offense, defense, special teams. And we have our three, you know, every side of the ball has a DNA to it. Those three things that, man, you want to be able, those things want to show up, you know, when you see us play on offense, when you see us play on defense, when you see us play on special teams. So a chance to really reinforce those and ingrain those in the new guys and reinforce them in the older guys and be able to see your 2021 team start to take shape here this spring. So, yeah, very, very excited about it. Can't wait to get out there.
All right, Dustin.
Paul actually just asked, I want to ask this question too about Jack Tuttle. I mean, you mentioned Michael probably won't be able to take very many reps at all. What do you think that can do for Jack's development? What are you kind of expecting out of him or hoping to see from him this spring?
Well, I think it's a big spring for him, you know, and I think that, you know, even with Dexter Williams as well, you know, those two quarterbacks are going to be taking a ton of reps. And you know, Jack has proved his worth last year on the field. He was a guy that we talked about a lot before that. And had not got a chance to play a lot on Saturdays. And that changed last year at the end of the year. And so just really looking forward to him having that opportunity to get all those reps. Another year of growth, another year of development. He's worked extremely hard in the weight room these last several weeks. And just to see him grow as both a football player and as a leader on our football team, because as we know and as time has taught us, that you're going to have multiple guys ready to play at every position. And then you got a guy like Dexter that has another chance for him to be able to grow and develop. And he was just, you know, seconds away from going into the game at Wisconsin, for sure. I thought he was going to go in that game. And then Jack came back. And then even in the bowl game, opportunities were right there. So bottom line is those guys' development is extremely critical to our program and as we develop to grow, to continue to grow and develop our team. And so, yeah, very big spring for those two guys. And I'm excited for Jack. He's an excellent quarterback.
All right, Zach, and then we'll wrap up with John.
Sorry, I'm kind of circling back to something that Kevin asked a while ago. I know you've talked through the last 9-10 months about little things that you kind of pick and choose that maybe you never would have put into kind of the daily operation of the program if it weren't for COVID and everything you had to do, that you feel like, hey, maybe we'll keep this going forward. But as you do start to plan for kind of life on the other side of this and you start to make some of those sort of conditional plans that you know, maybe by the summer you can do some things normally again. What are some things? I'm just curious that maybe you're still kind of thinking we're going to keep this around, even if by June or July things are opened up and we're able to operate closer to normal. What are maybe some things that you think are really going to stick for you in terms of just the day-to-day doing of the job?
Yeah, that is a good question. And we've talked about that quite a bit as a staff. You know, I think, you know, we kind of joke about that we're on Zoom all the time. But I tell you what, it's become a very, very strong mechanism to maximize your time. You know, and you just think about it from a recruiting perspective. We recruit young men all across this country. And it's not easy to be able to, especially on unofficial visits, to get to a certain campus. And so I think it's a tremendous way for us to get a whole bunch of people together on a call to be able to connect with them. We got the videos all made up that we've been using. We got all the people together. You can talk face to face. You can see, you know, people's reaction. You can see their faces when you talk to them. That's what's so different than a phone call. And so I see us continue to do that, you know, especially in the early stages of recruiting when you're trying to get to know families and get to them, get to know us and that whole piece. And I think same with our coaching staff, you know, be able to meet with other coaches, you know, and be able to get together. And you know, instead of getting on a plane and having to fly somewhere, you know, we can get on, you know, getting Zoom together and get on our boards and be able to talk football and share ideas and grow and learn in that regard, because, you know, it's a lot more, you know, cost effective to do that for us, you know, as a staff. And then I also think about, even we talked about during the season, to be able to maximize, you know, our days, you know, especially on a Sunday. Well, certain things we'll do together, but things you can do apart when you're working on your projects for you know, that game plan and different things you want to do. And I even think as well, I mean, what a great way for us to, for me to connect with our alumni. You know, you got alumni all across America. And how often do you get a chance to get them together, you know, it's hard, you know. And so I just think that's something I want to see us continue to do, for me to stay connected with. So I just think that's how you build your program and you get a network of guys together. I mean, we had all the former NFL players, the current NFL players, the former players from here, getting them on calls together and just being able to connect with the individuals that, man, maybe I haven't even had a chance to meet face-to-face because of just, you know, where they live and their jobs and all the things that they do. So I just think that I can see technology and the use of it really being maximized, you know. And I think even we've talked about how, as we have looked at the things that we did pre-COVID for fall camp, and I thought those were really valuable practice opportunities where, you know, we didn't have pads on, but we were able to get a ton of work in. We had smaller groups. Coaches worked with smaller groups. I thought the player development was increased because you weren't dealing with as many guys. And I just think things like that that we looked at, even we've talked about, even, you know, as head coaches in the Big Ten, how that the pre leading up to, you know, once we got the season was postponed or delayed, whatever word you want to use, and then we had the restart to play in October, that's where we start using those days and maximizing that time with our players. So I think there's things like that. You know, it's always about trying to improve the game, improve player safety. And also, you know, when you talk about the fall camp, I think that's going to affect the way fall camp looks. There's going to be some things that we will utilize from that we learned in COVID to allow us to better protect our players and reduce injuries and still get them ready to play, you know, a very, very physical Big Ten season.
All right, John, last one.
I was interested in that bull position. You're talking about DK Bonham staying there. Is this kind of the next evolution of the 4-2-5, having that hybrid linebacker defensive end? What kind of benefits does it bring having that there?
It really is. And, you know, we've actually, even as we've recruited the position, and I've said this in meetings with players and their families, that this is kind of the first time we've really kind of branched out. We changed the way we coach the position this past fall. And utilizing Coach Teagarden, he did a tremendous job with that. That was something that we actually made an adjustment, you know, during the year. You know, it wasn't even before the season. It was during the season. And it just seemed to kind of make sense. And I do think it's the next evolution in our system here that we're utilizing and trying to locate that guy and recruit that guy and figure out who that guy is and what kind of position does he play in high school to be able to find that best fit for that bowl. It's a critical position for us. And he has to have a lot of skill sets that to utilize. But it's a great tool for him because, you know, the way I look at it is a guy that can play that position when he goes to get to be draftable. He's, you know, all 32 teams can evaluate that young man, because whether you're a three down or a four down look, that guy's going to have the skill set to do both of those things. And so I think it just, it's like anything else, you know, when you're trying to envision what you're building for your team, it's not just about, hey, we want to definitely want to do what's best for us to win games now, but it's how can we recruit the best players, you know, to play certain positions. And so I just think that's just kind of definitely the growth of that position as we've tried to be able to you know, help us on our team as well as go recruit guys to fit that role. So really excited about those three guys, and we'll have you know, a chance to see some specific work with them and their position coaches as we divide up practice times and get them developed in the areas they need to be able to have to play at a high level at that position.
All right, thanks, Tom.
Have an awesome day. LEO.